Good afternoon, everyone. Hello, welcome to Hope and Anchor Community Church. As always, yes, it is such a privilege that you are here with us, that you are here to worship with us today. Especially today, today is Father's Day. So shout out to all the dads out there. But we really want to take time in this service as well, just to honor our fathers, whether that's biological, that could be spiritual fathers, father figures, the men in our life that have showed us what a godly man looks like, and ultimately is a reflection of God's heart. So we'll be doing that today as well. So we're going to go into our testimonies for today and hear about how some members of our church family, how their fathers have reflected the character of God in their lives.
Hey, I came here just to talk about my dad because it's Father's Day and it's the day we appreciate all our dads. And I wanted to talk about how I appreciate my dad and everything he does for me every day and night, all the time. Even if he doesn't want to or he's tired, he's always there for me. He's patient with me, even if I'm doing things wrong or right. It doesn't matter what I do. He's always there for me and helping me grow through the right way with God as well, not just his side of it. But he's always putting me on the right path. And I just came here to talk about how I appreciate him and everything he does for me day in and day out.
Hi, everyone. My name is Ina. And since it's Father's Day today, I wanted to share something about my dad and how I can see God in him. My dad, he's very generous with his time and just how he sees people. And that's something as well that God is with us. He's very generous. He's a generous father. He sees us and he comforts us. Another thing that I see in my dad is his kindness towards people. How he interacts and embraces people. And it's not always that you get that, no matter what walks in life people are at. And it's the same with God. He really embraces us, and he's kind and he's faithful and he comforts us. Another thing that I see in my dad is compassion as well, and how he feels with people. If people are mistreated or if he sees injustice, is something that he can react very strongly to. And that is the same thing with God. God, he is a compassionate God, and he shows compassion to us even if we look at our own lives and if we fail. He's there, and he's there to tell us that he loves us and he sees us. So we want to wish you a happy Father's Day to all fathers out there, and we just want to say that we love you so much, and we're so proud of you, and God is so proud of you.
Amazing. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to church. We are so happy and glad to have all of you here with us. I'm not going to lead worship, don't worry. We want to take a time to honor our fathers in the church, the ones that are becoming very soon fathers, the ones that are already fathers. We would like to honor them, pray for them. We have a few fathers, young fathers in between us. We know that it's a hard role. It's not easy. We get to learn as we have kids. Kids doesn't come with a book, right? So as you live together with them, you learn to be a mom, you learn to be a dad. You can make mistakes, and you learn from your mistakes as well. But it's a privilege to have fathers that are always there with us as moms. For the ones that are being for a long time mothers, or for the new mothers, it's so important for us to have their support and to have them next to us as we educate our kids, as we guide them to the Lord. We know that in this last decade, or more than a decade maybe, the family has been attacked very strong. And we don't celebrate Father's Day or Mother's Day as we used to celebrate these important days, even Family Day. I don't know how many of you know that in the 15th of May is Family Day. But we get to celebrate other days that maybe are not as important as family is. Family is the foundation of everyone, every one of us. Like, we all need to have a family, to have parents, people that are examples in our life, not just parents in like by blood, but as well as spiritual parents, people that look after our life. And we are a big family here, not just your blood family, but we are a big family here. And for us, it's so important that we can honor those fathers in that are here with us today. So I would like to invite all the moms that are here to come to the front with your kid, if you already have a kid, or if those kids are on the way, so we can honor those parents. And I would like to ask you if you can say something.
Just an honor to be here on Father's Day and to show our love and appreciation to all the fathers and in our lives. So we are so, so blessed and so thankful for each of you.
I mean, we have one on the way, so we're still expecting and learning our roles, I guess, but I feel so privileged to walk with my husband and just see him grow into this character of a father. And yeah, it's just such a privilege to be partners in this.
Everybody says this, but we have the best father. Sophia, right? Yeah. No. It's a privilege to celebrate Sophia's papa. Sophia's and Naomi's papa. I couldn't do this alone, clearly. But yeah, it's such a privilege to have someone walking with me in this and having a family. I love you so much. And I really, it's so beautiful to see as well how he can show me more of God's father heart as well for me through loving my daughters, our daughters. Yeah, thank you.
So maybe they want to say something?
I'll speak for both of us, but I guess thank you for putting up with me, because I know it can be a bit of a pain most of the time, if not all the time.
So we are very grateful, and we would like to ask you dads to come to the front, because we have a gift for you, and we would like to pray for you as well. We would like to pray for you, so if you can come here to the middle. Come. We have another father. Mom is not here, but she will look it through Zoom. Let's pray. Can I ask, Barry, can you pray for them?
See if I don't cry. God, we just want to thank you so much for who you are as a father and how you have given us such an example on earth of your fatherhood. And yeah, we just pray your anointing and your blessing over all of these fathers, the ones that have birthed children already and the ones that are expecting. God, yeah, we just pray for your wisdom and your anointing to just cover their heads, God. And yeah, that they can just walk in this true character that you've given, Jesus, that we can just be this like change in the society, that we can heal this brokenness in our society, God, by walking in your character. And we just thank you so much for them, for their hearts, and yeah, just the privilege that it is to walk alongside them, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Amazing. So I want to ask you to stand up because we are going to start worshiping God. We have a lot to celebrate. Maybe your dad is not close, is not here today, but we would like to honor all the fathers, the ones that are here and the ones that are not here, because they're as a blessing. Even if your dad was not that example that you wanted to have, but let's bless them. Let's say, God, thank you. Thank you for that person that you put in my life, with their good and the bad. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the family. Thank you for this time. Thank you that we can be together to worship you. Amen? Amen.
says, "The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance." And what an amazing day to celebrate the Lord, you know, and to celebrate all the fathers, you know, and everything that we see through the fathers and our own fathers, our spiritual fathers, just all of his heart that goes into that. And it's just really highlighting to me the inheritance that God has for us, that when he's our portion, we need nothing more, you know. There's nothing that is more valuable than his promises. And he's also not holding that inheritance from us. You know, that's something that we get to walk in now. It's not something we have to wait for, but we get to, you know, choose to walk in that inheritance now, and just how fulfilling and how valuable that really is for our lives. And just that we need nothing beyond that, you know, that money, things, you know, from people, like, nothing can fill that space but the Lord. So let's just pray together right now. Jesus, we just thank you for such a good father you are, God. That you're a father that is just so compassionate, so caring, so generous, God. And we just come to you today and just ask for more of that, you know, just to receive more of your portion, God, and to appreciate, you know, what it is to inherit your kingdom, God, you know. It's just such a beautiful gift that you offer to us, and just shows how valuable we are to you as your children, God. So I just pray for more understanding of that, and just for walking in that now, God. You know, that we don't have to wait for that, but we get to receive it now. Just amazing, God. So just thank you for your love. We thank you for your care, God, and everything that you do for us. Amen. So there will be some buckets coming around for cash, but if you don't have cash, there will also be card readers on either side that you can give that way. So let's continue worshiping together.
Father, thank you for your presence, Lord. Father, thank you for the fight. Thank you for the battle. Father, thank you for being able to worship you in the midst of our brokenness, our storms, Father. Father, the things that we are living, Father, have your way. Father, in a day like today, Father, You are the one that we're looking at. And Father, this is merely a human thing. You have been always been the Father, and we should ever and forever celebrate you every day. But Father, today we take a step forwards, Father, and say, Father, if it wasn't for you, none of this will be possible. Father, we join the heavens. Father, we join nature. We join the earth, Lord, as to say, you are the one. You are the one that we look at, Father. Father, we humble ourselves as humans, Lord. As people that think know it. People that know facts, but don't know maybe the heart. Father, we humble ourselves in front of the heart of the Father. Today we ask, Lord, that you will give us our daily spiritual bread, Father. Today you will feed us. Father, you will nourish us, Lord, beyond the week, beyond the month. That this will break today, Father, generational curses, Lord. Father, we ask for your spirit to move among us. And Father, we have seen you do it before. And we can trust you, Lord. So we trust you again and again, beyond what we can see, beyond what we feel, beyond what the circumstances dictate. Because Father, we understand that you are the one that holds all things together. And all of them are for the good of those that are following you, to be formed and transformed into your image, into who you are, Father, as to be your followers. So we surrender today. We ask for your peace, for your strength. Father, we ask for your clarity in Jesus' name. With me, you're too quiet. It makes me think you're concerned or afraid or confused. Don't say amen to any of those. You know what I mean? Say, I'm in the house of God. I am in the house of God, and I'm gonna get a word that God is gonna use to speak to my life. It might not be the same thing that it speaks to you, and you can speak to your neighbor in that sense, you know. You can point at someone very close to you or very far. But it's something that I need. Even if the enemy comes against me, I'm going to get what God wants me to get. Amen. That's like a Monday prayer, you know. Just going to give it to you on a Sunday, but it's a Monday prayer. It is what it is. Are you ready? The word of God is efficient to produce and to create an atmosphere. And I love when God comes into it with all of it. Today we are, I have to say that everything that we have been talking lately has been going in a chain. And I would love that we will have last Sundays, but we have some technical situations that didn't allow us to have last Sunday on YouTube. But I mean, keep it in your heart, speak it to someone, read the Bible. I can give you notes later if you want and you need, okay? But the reality of it is that we don't need the media to actually remind us that we have a Bible and a relationship with God that we can actually access every day, okay? Although that was good, what you can get from God is even better every time, in every moment, okay? So we have the privilege of standing here together and worshiping our King. But moments like this only mean something if we're hungry. How many of us are hungry for God? Yeah, today we're going to come out of the bat from Matthew 16. I was visiting an amazing church this morning, a Methodist church that one of our friend pastors had his last message today. And it was an amazing thing. And he preached out of the same verse. Says that I'm going to be preaching some, but I have a new twist and so on. Don't worry about it. He had other stories and God moves in different ways, but it is funny to me how God keeps having the same wind. His spirit is always leading in a clear direction, and we have it. And it says, Matthew 16, and we're going to start in verse 17, if it's possible. It says, Jesus replied,
something happened. They were walking with Jesus. The disciples were walking with Jesus, and something happened. Jesus stopped, and he asked them, after several things, you know when you are with this friend, and he manages himself, he does things every now and then in a certain way, one day you're going to stop and you say, hey, who are you, mate? And that doesn't have to be Bruce Wayne, you know. It doesn't have to be, you know, anyone extraordinary or out of a comic book. It could be someone that you know has something special. You know, the Lord gives us a spirit. When we accept him as our Lord, he gives us something in the inside that produces in us a weight of glory that dissects, that is able to discern, that is able to tell us there's something special in this person. You might have something wrestling with that person, but do you know that there's something special? And Jesus was walking with his disciples for a while already. Jesus was coming to church for a while. His disciples were just kind of going around the motions, but not going into the heart of God. And Jesus wanted to make a full stop. And he asked something. Who do you think I am? And to this is verse 17. Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. For this was not revealed. It was not revealed. You don't know this because you read it. It was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by the Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter. And on this rock, he just changed his name. And I tell you that you are Peter. And on this rock, Peter, Petros, rock, piedra. And on this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades, of hell, will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth, whatever you let loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. We move very quickly into Luke 8. And we're going to start from verse 22. And it says, one day, there's a specific moment Jesus chose for this. Jesus said to his disciples, let us go over to the other side of the lake. So they go into a boat and set out. As they sailed, he fell asleep. That's a Father's Day moment. A squall, fancy word for storm, came down on the lake so that the boat was being swamped, and they were in great danger. The disciples went and woke him, saying, Master, Master, we are going to drown. He got up and rebuked the wind and the raging waters. The storm subsided, both of them, and all was calm. Where is your faith? He asked the disciples. In fear and amazement, they asked one another. They didn't answer him. Who is this? He commands even the winds. And Jesus is like, oi, I'm here. I just asked you a question. You're talking, Who is this? He commands even the winds and the water, and they obeyed him. Then they sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, which is across the lake southeast from the Galilean Sea, if you're looking for geographic. Yeah. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. I love those. They're awesome. They're fun. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house. Man, days like today, they're warm. It could be cool. But had lived in the tombs. Not so cool. When he saw Jesus, he cried out. When he saw Jesus, make a mental note on that. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell onto his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, what do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me. For Jesus had commanded him, but he has seen Jesus. Jesus didn't say anything. Food for thought. He had commanded the spirit to come out of the man. Many times it had seized him. And though he was chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by a demon into a solitary place. The enemy is always going to keep you away. But verse 30 starts cleaning it up for us. Says, and Jesus asked him, what is your name? Legion, he replied, because many demons had gone into him. And they begged Jesus repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss, out of the region, hell. A large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside. And the demons begged Jesus to let him go into the pigs, and he gave them permission. When the demons came out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When those attending the pigs saw what happened, they ran off and reported this into the town and to the countryside, and the people. Gossip went out to see, yes, exactly that. Went out to see what happened. When they came out to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out. They found the man. So he was lost, but now he was found. They found the man sitting at the feet of Jesus. Dressed in his right mind. He was dressed in his right mind. And they were afraid. Why? Those who had sent it, who had seen it, told the people how the demon-possessed man had been cured. Then all the people of the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave because they were overcome with fear. So he got into the boat and left. And the man whom had the demons had gone from begged Jesus. But Jesus sent him away saying, return home and tell how much God has done for you. So the man went away and told all over the town how much Jesus had done for him. Thank you, God. Thank you for your word. Father, we need your revelation now. Ink is easy, but Spirit, only you. Will you have your way? Father, I don't know what you're battling inside of us. Each one of us has a storm, has a battle, and has a Gerasene. But if you will come into this room, we'll be able to sit at your feet, get instruction. Not only deliverance, but instruction. We're so blindsided by the deliverance. But what we need is instruction for our tomorrow, for our today, for what you want. So we ask that these words catapult us into that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Today we come on this subject titled Storm the Gate. And as we read in Matt and in Luke, Matt 16, Luke 8, actually doesn't look like that different from today. Today we have a mix of cultures and regions. We have a mix of a spiritual understanding. And when I mean spiritual understanding, I actually mean that we're standing under spiritual context. Not because you have professed Jesus, you are completely free. And I know there's a lot of cultural understanding in the church. If you were baptized and all that kind of stuff, it means you were super free. But why you keep on sinning and your mind is not getting transformed? You see, this is the nightmare of any pastor, to have to disclose this in public, because there's a lot of questions. But you know what? When God is God, you can do this. The reality is that we are in a mix of things that are cultural. Every family has a culture. Every circle of friends has a culture. Every church has a culture. Ooh, very secret. Everything, every person holds and upholds a culture. But is that the culture of Jesus? Everyone that is self-righteous says, yeah, I told you. But everyone that has fear of God and has known grace says, I just need to know what of my culture is not matching with your walking, with your order to go into the other side. Because that's the story. Jesus had ordered the disciples to go to the other side. In the middle of the situation, they were afraid. You don't care, we die. And Jesus was sleeping. He was snoozing out with popcorn in the bottom of the boat. That's like me in the living room with Mimi. Let's go and see a movie. And Dad, but you're not going to sleep? No. I'll try not to. At 3 popcorns later, I'm like, ouch. You know, like, and I'm like, I wake up and I'm like, I did it again. Britney Spears moment. Oh God, help me. She won't believe me next time. And God says, okay, don't worry about it. I'll hook you up. And then next morning she says, I know you're tired and so on. You know, you tried. And then your pride kicks in. Oh, but next time, next time. And I want to feel for the disciples in the first part of this, because in this context and in the life that we're living right now, we have so many things that will dictate that the storms that we have, the situations that we have, the asphyxiating, you know, realities that we have. We all have problems that are serious. Maybe it's not you, but have compassion. Maybe it's the person next to you. Don't play so perfect, because maybe they're playing perfect next to you. The things that we're living can be so rough, and we might be in the middle of a storm and not know it. I'll give you a good example. When I was a kid, I was brought up in the Caribbean. And Puerto Rico, 6 months out of the year, is prone to hurricanes. I used to escape, and my mom, my grandmas are going to be looking at that. I love you. I'm sorry. I'm still sorry. Sorry, grandma. Sorry, mom. I used to escape from inside of the house and tie myself with belts to the gates. The gates of the actual property, because I wanted to see if the wind could pick me up. I wanted to fly. But who doesn't want to fly? And you cannot judge me, because everyone wants to fly. You sang with Michael Jordan, I believe I can fly. I don't know who sang it, but Jordan was there. And I wanted to see if the wind of the storm was strong enough, the wind of the hurricane. So I never got scared enough. It's probably absent-mindedness. I'm a kid in my reality. My mom knew that there was like lampposts flying around, half ceilings flying away, and they could become a weapon, you know, in the air. I didn't know that. I wanted to see if the storm could take me out. And sometimes as Christians, we are naive of what we get into. And we are there challenging the situation without the revelation. We are there without having that moment that Peter had in Luke, saying, hey, you know, I mean, Matthew, we are there without the revelation that he's the Christos, the anointed. And we live our life maybe unaware, on a hopeful moment. I gave my life so everything should become perfect. And in a Father's Day, there's always a fathering moment. God is maybe saying, I need you to look more into who I am, to my character. It is not what I say. It is not if you like it. It's where I told you to go. And there's consequences. Are you willing? That's maturity. Jesus was walking with the disciples. They didn't know who he was. This moment that Peter answered, it was way after that moment going into the Gadarenes in the boat. Jesus had told them, go to the other side, I'll meet you. That was another story. You didn't lose it there. Guys, you didn't read the Bible? Jesus, in another moment, had done that. But in this moment, he just fell asleep. He also lost them. It must be that Jesus was actually cutting short the amount of questions. Sorry, the amount of time that the disciples could ask questions. As a father as well, sometimes I have one of my kids, the one could have kids, that, I'm not saying the name, but the one that could have kids, ask a lot of questions. And in the morning, I say, love, morning, how do you sleep? And sometimes, when she's asking 10,000 questions about the end of the day, I'm about to say, you have no faith? Are those the storms that you're talking about? I just woke up, and you're presenting me these little storms. But it's okay. Real storms are more difficult than teenage storms, they say. Although we drag teenage years nowadays for like 27 years more. And we are teenagers trapped in a 50-year-old body. And we are still creating the same mess that we should have done in the punk era. And we don't allow God to tell us off or tell us what to do because we still want to do our own will. But until you're not a father, you don't know how to shut up and actually say, God, you're God and I'm not. Father's Day. Bear with me. I'm going into the context. There's some amens there, but you are afraid, you know what I mean? So the context, if we want to. And we have to go through this very quick. The context is Jesus, and that's the cheese of it. The context is Jesus. Jesus says, you're going, and I have a purpose at the other side. So whatever happens, don't look so much at what happens on the way as much as you remember what I said. I am the Word. I sustain. Everything is sustained by the Word of God, says the Bible. So the Word is on the boat with you, and you are still thinking of the waves. So God is saying, I'm sleeping. Why have you not remembered? And sometimes we have to say to our memory, where is your faith? Before God has to ask the question. Sometimes we remember what is convenient. Sometimes we remember what we wanted from the situation. Sometimes we wanted to get to the other side, but we didn't stop to think that there might be things in the middle. If you have to go all the way to the other side, there's going to be a law in the middle. And we stay in our immaturity in life, in our walk with God, with what He said is going to happen, but we don't ask instructions of how to deal with the emotions in the middle. And that's called maturity. No kid comes with instructions. I have two of them. Both of them have become weirder by the years. And none of them came with a booklet. There was no one nurse or doctor for the high profile they were that gave us a book and said, don't worry about it. Read it. It's going to be good. No. No. I wish my wife had a book on how messed up I am. I would actually steal it away and read it. How to fix myself. Probably she can say the same thing of me if she's humble. If I knew how messed up I am, and in the corners I'm not going to learn, and I'm going to stop, and I'm going to rebel, and I'm going to try to do my own story, and I'm going to stop listening, I might become a disciple that is worth of the day that I'm living. But Jesus, such a good God, that He chooses us even though, and He still stands on His word, says, go on to the other side. And He teaches us how is it, most of the time, how is it look to go into the other side. But I have this situation. But go into the other side. But Lord, this happened. But go into the other side. But going to the other side. And sometimes we want to have everything so controlled in our walk with God that we judge others for their storm, but we are not dancing on our own. And we have the nerve to tell God of others' storms and to stand in their wind, that for you, it might be just a breeze, and judge them where they are. Let's just leave it there. Context is Jesus. Everything finishes good, but we're going to learn something out of this. Are you with me? Jesus got onto the other side, okay? There was a storm, but the storm is it's not the like the big picture. It's not the greatest thing. The storm is a natural storm. And today we're going to divide them in the middle, okay? He had ordered a destination and the storm was in the middle. The storm affected the natural things, but not the supernatural because Jesus was sleeping. So it might affect what you see and how you feel and your conditions, but it doesn't affect what God said of you. So today, first point, Jesus in the context, he sees the storm and he's in the midst of it, but he's not affected by your storm. So don't start giving to Jesus your need and your neediness as part of his character. He's in control. He's not worried about what is happening. We just need a better question. We just need to say something else than, don't you care? Because he said, you're going to go to the other side. Maybe a better question is, what are we going to do at the other side that this is happening? That was a better question, no? What in the world we're going to see at the other side? What kind of food we're going to see? Because, I mean, they knew that the other, I mean, you and me, because we're not Bible scholars and we are not Hebrews from 3,000 years ago, we don't know that in that area, they were raising pigs, so they were not Jewish. They had kebabs. It was not like they were like, and the pigs were running in the field. No, no. They were Gentiles. So it was another culture. So Jesus was not only crossing to the other side geographically. He was actually changing cultures. So the storm, every time you change cultures, will come to meet you there. Every time you change culture in your friendship, in your relationships, in your finances, remember this, a storm is going to come. Every time you say, I'm going to start tithing, I'm going to give you a prophetic word, oops, it's going to get difficult. If you don't believe me, start tithing. And then you let me know. Every time you start actually saying to your friends why you are so devoted to reading the scriptures and living the scriptures because there's a God that can save their lives. Remember this. If you had 10, it might be down to 2 if you're lucky. Because every time you come against a culture, you're going to come under the spirits or you're going to have to defeat the spirits of the culture. And the storm only came to say what Jesus and the disciples were going to face at the other side. I have not forgotten that we're still talking about keys and gates. Don't worry about it. The idea is that we understand that when we get to the other side, there's a person that we'll meet, that we will meet, that Jesus will meet, that met, that is a gate. Oh, you gates, lift up your heads, Psalm 24. Lift up your faces, your heads up. Think differently. So the King of Glory can come through you. So if you think differently, the people of the region were thinking in a specific way. They were afraid because they thought of the man and the disease that he had. He was possessed. And they were afraid because their sources, their pigs had died. But their way of thinking never changed. That Jesus actually can go all the way to the other side with us and do the miracle. But maybe the people that hear you never change their minds. What a difficult moment, eh? If it happened to Jesus, it will happen to you. Don't worry about it. Don't be afraid of still going to the other side. Be obedient. So the context had Jesus, and he ordered us a destination. To where? To Gadara. Southeast, as we said, it was Gentiles, so they were partly Roman or very impregnated into the cultures of the Roman and in the area because there was a lot of soldiers in the area. And it was part of a confederation of 10 people, so they had friends. You know, when you hear someone say something in the streets and you say, oh, that was pretty good, mate. And then you look at the other friends to see what they thought about it. That was the culture. That was the moment. But we're talking about masses of people, okay? I know you didn't come for Bible studying and knowing what the context is, but I'm just going to give it to you anyways because you're forced and it looks bad if you left. But Jesus came for influence. It's the influence. It's not about you. Your storm is not about you. That's why Jesus was able to sleep. He was going to storm a gate. But before that, because it was an order from God, he could rest. And sometimes we want to storm everything on the way, and we don't take momentum. We don't take a moment to see what are the fights and the battles that I have the keys for. Jesus was sleeping. He needed to do his thing at the other side. The disciples that knew boats, Jesus was a carpenter. He was sleeping. Don't try to do everything by yourself. Jesus himself rested. There's moments that you have to call your friends and say, you know what? I'm going to rest. Maybe go home, have a tea, read a bit of the Bible, and say, God, is there anything here you want to tell me? Is there anything here I can grab substance from that you can sustain my soul in? You are my Father. What is it that you have for me? And he meets a man in the door, a doorman. This is the gate guy, the Gadarene, the one that everyone remembers about because he's the possessed guy. He's the doorkeeper. I don't know if you have seen Thor, right? Anyone seen Thor? And there's a guy that's massive. I mean, it's obscenely big, like that, you know, or at least because of the color, yellow color of his eyes, you think he's big. I don't know if it's the muscles or the eyes, but we all think he's big. You thought he was short? I mean, no, he was big. Okay, cool. I mean, I thought I was the only one. And all of a sudden, this guy, in a certain specific situation, he said, I am the one that's guarding this gate, the entrance. And he was not going to give it away. This man was guarding the gate to Gadara. He had the reputation of Gadara. Gadara was possessed, was under a lot of spirits and cultural understandings that were far from God, from Jesus. And Jesus was storming that gate. But to storm that gate, he needed to storm the reputation of that gate, the man of Gadarene. We don't know his name. We don't hear from Gadarene anymore. We just hear from this guy. That's how I know that he was the one that was holding the gate. But I ask you, and I'm just going to start planting this in your head right now, what are the gates that you represent? Because you think it's just coming maybe to church or to do the right thing, but then you have a job. But maybe your job is part of the description of your gate. This man could not be with others, but he had a reputation. His influence was all over the region. 10 provinces knew about this guy. His influence, the understanding of being down and depressed and depleted, was all over the nation because of him. What is it that you represent? What is the gate that you have? And are you ready to storm it? Jesus showed us how to develop momentum. He showed us how to do the storming. Storming sounds so ego. It sounds so Thor style. It sounds so superhuman. You know, we have to be so tough to do it. But Jesus was resting. So to storm the gate that we represent, and that's your question for answering, what is the gate? First of all, you need to be resting on his guidance, direction. Jesus said, go to the other side. He rested. There's direction, there's rest. If you have direction, you have to rest. Something comes in the way, you stay in your rest. Even if it jumps from the corners and it spills from the seams, friendships goes down, bank account goes down, everything, your visa, your plane ticket, your mom, your iPhone. If you're safe, you have Android, we're still praying for you. even if you don't lose your position of rest because you have direction. If you had revelation of the direction, and who is the one that actually called you there? And why do I say that? Because when Jesus was at the other side, the first thing that happens is that Jesus, in his spirit, Jesus gives at the other side of the sea direction. And the direction of God will start rebuking demons at the other side of the way. So you don't have to think, oh, when I get there, I might have to figure it out. No, no, no. The person that was at the other side knew already everything that was inside. Legion. Legion is from 100 to 1,000, depends on how you see it. But it was a lot, let's say like that. And it was organized. Everything that was organized at the other side, and it was working because he had a reputation, because the people were limited to what they were doing and thinking. Jesus, when he said, let's go to the other side, he confronted, and the storm came in the natural to represent what was happening in the supernatural. So a physical storm attacked the ones that were looking at it naturally, disciples, you, me. But the real fight is in the supernatural. What is actually confronting the power in the place. Someone asked me a couple minutes ago, hey, is this happening a lot? This happens every Sunday when we're having the shouts and situations. And I said, well, the last 3-4 Sundays have been interesting. Yeah, it's true. When God starts lifting up the temperature, things happen, and things start crying out. In this moment, this gathering possessed. Don't look at everyone around you like they were so hot on worship, because this man was worshiping you, the Son of God. He was worshiping out of his own convenience. Maybe that's a question that you can ask yourself. Am I worshiping God out of my own convenience? Because that's your next step of maturity. Maybe you come to church and then you complain about things that are said because you're worshiping God. You're trying to live the word out of your own convenience. But when we are disciples and the word of God disciples us, the word of God is supposed to rebuke us and encourage us to actually live how he is teaching us to do. He's saying, look, look. Giving you direction. And if you're going to worship me, you're going to worship me in the right place. This guy was possessed. He was definitely not worshiping in the right direction. The demons were acknowledging who Jesus was. The disciples didn't know who Jesus was. It was later that he said to Peter, hey, God revealed that to you. But at that moment, Peter still didn't know. And the disciples either. This conversation is happening in different zones. It's like AM and FM. It's like a radio. You know, you have the disciples that are there, and they're like FM, and they're like, what in the world? You know, and you have some like adverts and kind of trendy songs that come through, you know, and they're thinking about where's the next kebab place, because we at the end of the day managed to get outside of the Jewish territory, so we're gonna have some proper pork now. Joking. It's Father's Day. Just give me that. You know what I mean? I'm not sinning. It's not blasphemy. It's just whatever. Don't judge me. And then all of a sudden, you have the AM, the real thing. You have the demons actually being confronted because Jesus looked at the guy with a decision when he took the shore. He said he got out of the boat with a love and a decision that shook hell itself. That shook the spirits that were in the other side. So Jesus walks into the situation full of grace, full of authority, shaking everything as it comes. Bubbles coming out of every corner and spits. And the disciples are saying, what in the world is going on? We thought the storm was weird. And we thought the storm was weird when he said, be still. And the winds and the water shut down. But now we have spirits, or this weird guy, who knows, that is completely cut and naked, running towards Jesus saying, I adore you. But something in his spirit is wrong. And then I wonder if they managed to get that the conversation was going in AM and not FM. Their conversation was used as, don't you care? Themselves, Christianity today. Ooh, I have to feel good. I'm going to hug you to believe Jesus. No, you're not. They either repent or they won't. But we don't want to go through the storms. And now I'm going to give you a rain check on that. You're going to get a storm. The man comes in. And Jesus, if we can say a human word, talks with, comes into an agreement out of grace. God is so good that he had grace. I mean, the direction was going to happen. The area is going to know what he does and who he is. Don't worry about it. That's not going to change. God is God. Nothing. He's immutable, unchangeable. But God, full of grace, he said, what's up? Who are you? He didn't ask for the name of the person. He asked who had taken and given an authority, an identity, and influence to the region. He said, who are you? I'm Legion. Ah, so who? That's who they know. I wonder what is that people know about us. Because I know you never think you're the gathering. Never. I mean, never. You didn't wake up as like, hello, God, how are you, mate? I'm the gathering. Good morning. I'm completely possessed by structures and control and ways of thinking. And I influence people in a certain way. My family thinks of God because of what I live. And maybe all of that is skewed and into the corner. But maybe, that's not you. I know, this is not sugar-coated. Well, it's Father's Day, so I can tell you everything. This is how I conversate with God. God, I'm the gathering. Okay. Amen. What is it that we have in us that is the influence in the area? That is actually what God has given us and the enemy has attacked and possessed. That is the blessing that God has for a region and we're not taking the most out of. What is it that God directed us to do and we have not believed and we're still looking at the storm? What if we were called to be that storm at the other side and God just gave us a storm as an example of what it should be our attitude? Sometimes we go through the struggle and we think, ah, poor me. But disciples should be the ones that observe the storm and say, wow, is this the style? This is how we're going to go at the other side? And we are apprehensive. We are actually awoken by the situation. We're not victims of what we're living. We are there to live as disciples. Disciples didn't know. AM, FM. And Jesus finishes with this. Jesus says, you know what? Out. They asked for the pigs. The pigs were gone. And a lot of people actually kind of think about the pigs. And in the area, probably they thought about the pigs because that was like the matter of their subsistence. You know, it was a lot of meat and probably farm life and all kind of stuff. But I'm starting to look at it differently. Maybe it was the pain and not the pigs. And sometimes we are so in love with the pains that we live that we stop going into the gate and storming it because we have pain. And we are asking Jesus, just let it go. Just let it go. With this, we start closing. To have an attitude that storms the gate, you cannot be looking at your pain, and you cannot be looking at your storm in a way that you're so infatuated that you become a victim. If you look at your storm, have it as an example of how strong you gotta go, because the promise is bigger. When you go, you go because God said, let's go to the other side. And he always has something to do. God doesn't lose time. We might. We might play to be Christians, but God doesn't play to be God. And we know that. The enemy will respect the authority of God over your life if you stay directed by who is with you, and that's God. And also, there's a why we're going to the other side. There's an influence. Some of us will pray for influence. Some others are apathetic to influence because they're self-centered. But God, Jesus, the disciples, you and me, we're people that influence. So if you have apathy about influencing, maybe ask God, what is it that is stopping you? Maybe, no, but I have rejection. I don't want to influence people. Maybe there's something there that you need to tackle. Maybe there's some healing that needs to happen. I don't want to be seen. Maybe there's some healing that has to be happened. Today, Father's Day, God wants to say, I want you to expand the territory. I want you to go through the storm, be taught by the intensity of the storm what should be your attitude at the other side, to live and to obey, to be directed, to be free, to walk on what I have given you, for it would influence many. In this case, it was 10 provinces, not only one life. Your storm didn't come to inspire you only. That storm came to set you free, so you will be influencing more than you. So your relationship with God is not about you. Don't think so close to your story. Don't fall in love with you so much that you don't have space in your heart to love the nation, your community, your street, your family, your friends, in a way that it actually resembles the freedom and the direction that He has given you. Second, we expand the territory, and we're here to win. We're not here to have a conversation. We're here to bring results. We don't take the guy back in the boat. Jesus said, although He wanted to leave with them, the gathering, but when He was in right mind and closed, He said, Jesus, can I go? And Jesus said, no, you stay. Because it was not about having a happy clap and having a comfortable life with Jesus. And let me read my NIV version every morning. It was about being someone that it will influence others. He said, no, you stay and let everyone know what God has done for you. He didn't even take the credit. Jesus said, let everyone know what God did for you. Jesus didn't touch him. He didn't preach to him. He didn't have a proper conversation. The first time that Jesus really talks to the guy and not to the demons is when He said, no, you don't come. Oh, that's for you, like fluff, sugar-coated Christianity. When Jesus says, don't come. I should have called that there. It would have been better, no? When Jesus says, don't come. Go. Don't come. Go. Don't feel comfortable. Go. The disciples didn't know the type of brokenness that this guy had. But he could be thankful in a different level. He owns a gate. He was owning the gate. He went back and everyone knew. And maybe the gates that we're looking today have to do with maybe the spheres of society. Maybe it had to do with your friends. Maybe, you know, we can go through them arts and the economics and education and health. I don't know what gate is in you. But I know the enemy started creating storms a lot ago in your life. Way before you knew what you were supposed to be doing, He was already doing what He had to do to stop that boat, to stop meeting with the one that makes you free. That's the gate. What is it that you have to storm? We are us, the Christians, that will come into towns and will be known like the ones that will turn her around, and no one could say anything else but, these are the guys that are causing problems. We are the Christians that will stand on the gap. Well, the fathers and mothers in a day like today that will stand in the gap of our sidewalks and not produce excuses and sugarcoat needs, but provide a way out of a situation. Where are we on our lives? Where are we walking with Jesus? Are we still fixing our eyes on our little storm? Or are we influenced by the storm to see that He's taking us to see things differently? That all of us wanted to be stopped. There's people in this room, very likely, they were abused, molested by friends and family. Health was not on your side when you were young. You are here because you're a miracle. You are here because that happened to you in that crash, in that car crash, was supposed to take you out, but it didn't. People that have had that same disease or that same situation, they are not telling the story like you are. This is when it gets real. When you stop looking at your little storm and you put your feet behind Jesus at the other side of the shore and say, I'm where I'm have to be. I might not know what I'm doing. I might not have the possessions I need. I might not have the money, but I have an idea. I have a calling from God. And God is saying, I want you to storm your gate. Because you are the one that if we go back to Matthew says, you are that church that those gates will not be able to stop you. You are that gate that can look up and say, King of glory, come through me. We are already at the other side of that shore. I don't know where this word catches you. I know I gave you a lot of context and I actually kind of bulldozed a lot of things. But if you have to stay with one thing, He's saying, you are a gate. Jesus has chosen you to affect and influence more than you. Don't live a life and a freedom in Christ that only affects you. That's not called freedom. Live a life and a freedom in Christ that affects others, because that's how He lived. That says Christ very loud. Also, don't look at the storm as your limitation. Look at your storm as an inclination of how to put your heart towards God. Respect the direction and follow through. Respect the direction and follow through. And if you don't know what gate do you have in your life, today it's time to ask God. We might be a congregation, but you might be holding the streets in your hand. You might be holding the health systems, the elderly houses. You might be holding treasures that don't know that Jesus is for them in your life. And maybe you're losing your time looking at others' storms and criticizing that instead of getting into the other side and being of an influence. The ones that are running ahead into their gates, the ones that are storming their gates, don't have time to judge someone else's gates. Run fast. Run free. Run with God. Because He's about to do something. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, thank you for storming through our little times, our stamina to stand in front of you, to listen to your word. Thank you for God being that Father that stops us in our tracks, Lord, and encourages us, Lord. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Thank you for being so able to lead us from one side to the other. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we want everything you've done today, everything you taught, whatever was good and holy and came from you, Lord. Father, remind us during this week. Remind us, Father, when we are alone. Father, remind us when we are about to, Father, just go to you and wake you up without faith. in the middle of the week say, hey, don't you care? Father, lead us to know how you're thinking. Lead us to trust, to mature in our faith, Lord, and the faith that you give us, Lord, and go further and step out of the boat, encouraged by the storm, looking for what you want to deliver, holding up high, Father, the influence of, Father, influence, the sphere of influence that you've given us. Father, give us today, Father, a revelation that each one of us holds a gate, holds a moment. Father, holds a possibility to love others in a way that cannot be measured, Father. We bless you. We have a good report, but we want better. Father, we have seen people. Father, we have experienced your glory, but we want to see more. Father, we today ask that you convert us. You make of us people, Father, that deliver seed when there's no seed. Father, you make us bread when there's no bread. Father, that you make us light when the people are sitting in darkness. Father, let us be salt when people have not flavor and they're just dulled up with the flavors of society, Lord. Father, have your way. Come, and we will go with you. Come to the other side and lead us, Lord. Lead us, Lord. Everyone in this place has a sphere in their heart, has something that they have been doing, things that have been reaching out. Maybe you see as a job. Maybe you see as your group of friends. But maybe that's your door. Maybe you have been asking God, what is my calling? What do I do? What do I add? Is this it? Just to go on Sundays? Just to go to connect groups on the week? To read the Bible? And then the rest stays the same? No, God transforms all things. Maybe today you're called to be that figure of a father or mother in a sphere that is lost, that has no direction. That is the role of a father and a mother. Today as a father, the father of the house, I pray anointing of freshness over each one of us to influence, Lord. Father, the spheres that you've given us, Father, of truth and understanding, Father, an anointing that is fresh and delivers, Father, that doesn't come from us and our own old understanding, but it comes from your Spirit, Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your Holy Spirit today will seal us, Lord, with new purpose. Father, with knowledge of the purpose, with direction, with strength. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, every person in this room, in the name of Jesus.
Now desperate for your presence, longing to be with you. Lead me to a new place, more of you. Through the fight, I'll persevere. I won't submit to any fear.
Yes, Jesus, you are all that we need, Father. And Lord, we are desperate for you. We're desperate for your presence. So as you pursue us with your love, God, we want to just declare that we are pursuing you with everything that we have, Father. Because it doesn't matter the storm that we're facing, God. We will rest because we know that you are all we need and you are with us. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to have any fear. No worry, no doubt, God. Because if you have set us on a direction, Father, if there is a shore that you told us that we are heading to, God, there is no storm that is bigger than you, Jesus. Oh, Father, you are all that we need. In you, there is no lack, Father. But you are a God of abundance, Lord. Abundance joy, abundant peace, abundant hope, Father. So whatever it is, God, that in the storm that is trying to distract us, God, wherever we feel that lack that we're trying to fill or trying to control, Father, Lord, we ask that you would come in and show us who you are in that area, Father. That we would rest in your abundant hope, that peace, God. Thank you, Lord, that you are with us. And if you're not freaking out, we don't need to be freaking out either. Jesus, we want to be a people that know that our God is bigger than our storm. Would we stand in that, Father? When we go out in our week today, whatever we encounter, God, whatever storm, maybe we're in the middle of one, maybe one's going to come soon, God. But we choose to stand in the truth, Lord, that you are with us, that you are bigger than any situation, and if you say go, we will go. Because you are good. Then we will storm those gates, God, because we believe that you have a plan and a purpose for our lives, God, to bring others into your kingdom, Father. You are so good, Jesus. We're so grateful for this time that we can have with you as a family, Lord, ministering to your heart as you minister to us, Lord. We don't deserve any of this, Father, but thank you so much for your grace that you lavish on us. You are so worthy, you are so holy, Lord, of all of our praise, our adoration, God. We love you so much, Jesus. And Holy Spirit, would you fill us as we go out this week with this confidence, resting and knowing who you are. And that you are with us, you are in us, you are fighting for us. You go before us, and you're behind us as well, Lord. You hem us in completely. Thank you that we are yours, and you are ours, Lord. How beautiful is that? We love you, we worship you, we give you all the honor of today, Lord. All the glory. And the church said, amen. Amazing. God is so good, guys. This week we're going to remember, right, that our God is bigger than our storm. And that there's no storm that he can't lead us through. If he said to go to the other side, we're going. Because he knows what's best and he is with us. There is no fear in his perfect love. Amen. Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for coming again to Hope and Anchor Community Church. As always, it is a privilege to worship with you, not just to be here to put on some nice, you know, music and have a great word, you know, to challenge us, but to be family with one another and to actually encourage one another as we actually minister to God's heart. I feel that today. Like, I feel like today, you know, when you feel God's presence, but it's not just us trying to receive from him, but we are ministering to his heart as well. And it's that communion that we are here for, to commune with our Father. I'm sorry, guys. I'm just still so hyped. I know I should be wrapping this up. But yeah, so as we go on this week, remember that there are so many ways that you can stay connected with the church family. We have Heart Connect groups. We've got men's and women's that meet throughout the week. We have different evangelism times as well, and that happen on Friday and Saturday. So if you want any information on any of those, come talk to me or anyone you see up here. We'll be able to give you some more information. Or actually, anyone with a volunteer name tag, because those are quite new. So if you see one of those, go to ask questions. As well as the Camden Town Community Choir meets on Thursdays. So if you have any questions about that, you can talk to lovely Sadie over there. But yeah, guys, we've got a good God. He is for us, and we're going to make it through the storm. Amen? All right, we'll see you next week, everyone.